So I'm going back to this mixture fraction questions. There's a very simple property of the mixture fraction, which is the following, is that if you have a premixed flame, so now, okay, I am in the diffusion flame business, but I'm moving back again to the premixed flames. In a premixed flame, if you have a certain mixture fraction Z in front of the flame, you have the same in the burn gases. How do you prove that? It's quite easy. If you look at the state of the fresh gases, Y fuel 1, YO1, in the state 2, in the burn gases, you will have YF1 minus a delta. And if you have a delta on the fuel, you will have a S delta on the oxidizer, because S is the stoichiometric ratio. So you see that this is the initial state, this is the burn gases. If you plug that in the definition of Z, you find that Z2 is equal to Z1. So through a flame front, the mixture fraction does not change. Well, okay, I'll be back to that. But to first order, if the Lewis numbers are equal, the mixture fraction should not change through a flame front, which is actually a funny property. Oh, this may be too much for you. Can you decrease it a little bit? Or? Yeah, it's either. This is too much. Yeah, we had it. We had it 5 minutes ago, so. So okay, you have to, this is often seen as what we call a state space, a state diagram. Every point here corresponds to something in the real world. For example, this point corresponds to the moment where you are in the oxidizer stream and you're just entering the chamber. Good luck, okay? It's just the air stream. On the other side, you have the fuel stream. Here you are sitting in the fuel stream, you get ready to enter the chamber. If you mix, you're going to be on this line. And obviously, there are two things you can do in this chamber. You can either mix fuel and oxidizer, or you can burn them. So if you mix, and the amount of mixing will depend on Z. Okay. For example, here I took Z of the order of half. That means I will have half mass coming from fuel and half from oxidizer. You will be somewhere on the mixing line. Now, if you burn now in a premixed flame, you will just move up at a constant Z now. Okay? So you can see a diffusion flame as a process where you mix first, and once you have mixed, according to your Z value, then you burn, and you go up there. Of course, the time it takes to go from here to there is not infinitely small. If chemistry is fast, it is infinitely small. If chemistry is not infinitely fast, it will take a certain time. So if you sample the flow, you're going to find points along this line. But that really means also something, is that all the points have to lie inside this triangle. This is what we call the possible states. And if you do a measurement or a computation, and we often do that with PhD students, and we ask them to plot their points in this diagram, if you find points here, you're in trouble. Okay? Especially if you set the Lewis to unity. If the Lewis are not equal, then you can have funny things. But basically, you should be within these states. Now, the limits of this Z diagram, we see that almost everywhere. But can you really believe in this Z ID? So I want to come back to the assumptions we made to define Z. First thing, I've shown that yesterday. This is a plot of the Lewis number as a function of distance in a premixed flame, but it could be in another flame. I used that to show you that the Lewis numbers of each species were almost constant in the fresh and in the burn gases, which is great. But I didn't use it to tell you they were equal, because obviously they're not equal. Obviously, saying that all these Lewis numbers are equal is tough. Not even saying they're equal to unity, but even saying they're equal is far-fetched. So the assumptions that we've used to explain that, you know, we can build a mixture fraction this way, they are not justified by the measurements. We know that the Lewis numbers are not equal. Now, when people have seen that, they have started working on improved definition of Z. For example, instead of taking mass fractions, you can think, for example, that elements would be a better choice, because those things are really conserved. This is what we call generalized mixture fractions. And now when you go in the literature, you will find many of them. So for example, this is a passive scalar, which looks at hydrogen. So you take all the species you have in your flow, which contain hydrogen, you count the number of moles that you have, so you divide by the molecular weight, and you build a passive scalar with that. That's the total mass of hydrogen in your box. And this is conserved, okay? Hydrogen can, the hydrogen, the element, not the molecule, the basic hydrogen element cannot go anywhere. Either you find it in H2 or in H or in H2 or OH, I mean, cannot become carbon. And from that you can define the mixture fraction, and this is a definition which is often used. And actually people try to hybrid this thing by mixing a ZH like this with other definition, and the most famous one is probably Bilger's definition. Bob Bilger, you know, is one of the famous guys in this field, and he proposed the definition and he said this one is probably one of the best definitions you can use for Z. Why is it one of the best? Well, because none of them is equivalent to a real passive scalar. The reason for that is that this quantity does not diffuse. If you want to build a mixture fraction, you want to be able to have the same diffusion coefficients, and none of them diffuses in the same way. So none of these things are real passive scalar. So there's a group which is really leader in that field. It's the group of Sandia, Bob Barlow here. And what Bob did, which was really great actually, he used many definitions of mixture fraction and he compared them. This is what he's doing here. So this is one definition of mixture fraction, and those are other definitions, and that's the difference between the two. So you see here the definition of mixture fraction based on C element, on H, and here he's using another one, and you see they're not equal. They're almost equal, but they are different. And so in practice, it really means you have a problem with mixture fraction. Many models use it, but in practice, this thing just does not exist. And that's a major problem. But again, as I've said yesterday, you don't want to be a perfectionist. If this model allows you to make the computation, you just have to be conscious, for example, that if you have a hydrogen flame, probably talking about mixture fraction is going to be very, very difficult. If you have a methane flame, look at methane here. Methane has a Lewis number of 0.9 something, so saying it's equal to unity, well, it's probably good. I mean, it's just it's reasonable. But you have to be aware that this is an approximation. It's not exact. So just remember that there is no such thing as a real mixture fraction because the diffusion of all these species are never equal. And in practice, we may have different Z values. Now, I'm going to start the turbulent session in pretty soon. I just want to mention here that this problem of non-unity Lewis number is solved by many people in the turbulent combustion community with some kind of argument which we use also, which says, in a turbulent flow, where you have a lot of turbulence, what transports species is vortices, turbulence, what we call turbulence transport. I will talk about it tomorrow. And so turbulent transport does not discriminate between species. If I am a big vortex, I take you and you and you, I take all of them. I don't care if you're H2 or CO, I take all of you together. So I just set Lewis equal to unity for everyone. And a lot of turbulent combustion models begin by saying Lewis equal unity for everyone. It's a strange argument. The best argument to do it is it makes your life much simpler. Okay? Because if you say Lewis equal unity at point one, then of course life gets much easier. But you have to be worried about that too, because if you go to Kemkin or Cortera and you want to compute a premix laminar flame speed and you set all Lewis numbers to unity, believe me, you're going to have surprises. The flame speed will be wrong by 60%. So we know that in a flame, in a real flame, Lewis numbers are not equal. We cannot say that. But again, now we're going to start turbulent combustion. You're going to see that in the world of turbulent combustion, sometimes there are things you need to do. Now, in the same way that you can take a premix flame and stretch it, you can take a diffusion flame and stretch it too. Same thing. You have a surface, you can stretch it. The effect of stretch in a diffusion flame is very different. The first thing you have to remember is that premix flames are not very sensitive to stretch to first order. But diffusion flames are incredibly sensitive to stretch. They are very, very sensitive to stretch in many ways. So stretch is actually a difficult quantity to use in diffusion flames, and a lot of people in the community prefer to use scalar dissipation. Okay, scalar dissipation is a quantity which is two times the diffusion coefficient of heat or of species. We suppose they are equal, so it's not important, multiplied by grad z square, the gradient of z square. The gradient of z square is linked to stretch because when you stretch a flame, you increase the gradients. So when you increase the scalar dissipation, you increase the stretch. Those quantities are linked. But in practice, there's a nice thing about that, is that this quantity does not depend on the flame orientation. While stretch is always difficult to define, because stretch is defined only in the plane tangent to the flame front. So for many models and many codes, it's much easier to work with scalar dissipation. So let me give you an example here of a planar flame. If you solve the equations for this flame, theoretical equations, you find that the scalar dissipation in this flame is a function with a complicated expression here, but which is proportional to stretch. Okay. So you can use either stretch or scalar dissipation. And when you read papers, you will see some communities saying, I have a high scalar dissipation. The others will say, I have a high stretch. In practice, it's the same. Okay. Same concept. It just means that you are stretching the flame, blowing on it, or stretching it in the other direction. Same issue. Now, this is an example of a plot in a laminar diffusion flame where you're blowing from this side and from that side, and the flow goes, the burn casters go this way and that way. This is the temperature profile, and this is the velocity profile. The velocity goes to zero here, and of course, you can see here the stretch. That's why that's the reason why the flow field looks like this. Now, I'm not going to make the derivation here, but again, using the arguments I just made here, you can derive the total reaction rate. You remember I talked about the total reaction rate in the premixed flame. It's the integral of the reaction rate. Now, I said chemistry was infinitely fast. You want to think about that. That doesn't mean that you're burning the whole universe, okay? It just means that you're burning locally, like a Dirac function. There's a function which burns everything at one point, but the integral still has a finite value that you can compute. And the integral is given here. And this is the integral, this is the total fuel which is burned in a stretch diffusion flame as a function of stretch. You see that it goes like the square root of stretch. And you see also something else, is that it goes up, you know, very rapidly if it's square root of A. So when you stretch a diffusion flame, it burns much more. Remember what I've shown for premixed flames. You know, premixed flames were almost insensitive to that. This is why you must blow on a fire. Okay, when you make a fire, well, I know in the US you don't do real barbecue, but in France we burn wood. If you burn wood, you want it to burn, well, you have to blow on it. Okay, that's the first thing you learn. And because the wood fire is basically diffusion flame, you get gas coming out of the wood and it needs some air, so you send it more air. That means you stretch it. That's why you need stretch to feed the diffusion flame. Now, at the same time, this formula, which is derived for infinitely fast chemistry, does not capture what's happening in a real wood fire, for example. If you stretch it too much, if you blow too much on it, you quench it. So this formula is not valid for all stretch values. What's happening in the real world, this is the stretch, or the strain, or the scale dissipation, whatever you want, you know. This is the amount of air you're blowing into your flame. This is the theory as a square root of A, and this is the practice. If you're blowing too much on the flame, then it suddenly quenches. And diffusion flames, you know that they are easy to quench. You know, that's those the big lazy flames. If you blow on them, you can quench them. So that's again a field where you find the same number, the same animal, which is stretch, and it's very important for the flame structure. And again here, you have the same thing. The stretch definition depends on the flow and on the shape of the flame, and this is going to be important for turbulent flames in a few seconds. Okay, let me finish now on this kind of things before I start turbulent flames. An important question is, I talked about perfectly premixed cases and perfectly non-premixed, or let's say diffusion flames, but are there other flames? Well, there are other flames. I just want to mention two of them, triple flames and partially premixed flames. That's an example here of a case where you have triple flames here at the bottom. So what is a triple flame? It's directly connected to what I've just said. I've shown you that in a diffusion flame you have two states. States where things just mix, and states where things have burned in an infinitely fast chemistry. But there's an interesting question. How do you go from one to the other? How do you separate the mixing lines from the ignited points? Well, in other words, how do you go from the blue line to the red line? Triple flames are doing that for you. So let me show you a triple flame. It's not a mythical animal. Huh? It exists in the real world. If you inject here fuel and oxidizer, and you don't start the flame right away here. So here you have only mixing. So you are on the mixing line. And you know there's a flame somewhere where you have a diffusion flame. It will look like this. So here it will be hot, here it will be cold. So it really means that in between you need something. You need something to ignite this thing. This is the triple flame. And this is a picture, a very classical picture by Chione. I think this guy was at Cambridge. What you see here is really this triple flame. Why do we call it triple? Well, because it has three branches. And these three branches create an animal which is able to take here things which are not ignited and to transform it into a diffusion flame here. So, by the way, I can talk about the geometry of this thing. This thing here is a diffusion flame. It will keep going. This thing here is a rich premix flame branch, and this one is a lean premix flame branch. And this triple flame has been discovered not long ago, maybe 10 or 15 years now. We didn't know it before. We didn't even know it existed. So when we started seeing these pictures, people said, wow, yeah, that's cute, you know. This thing is moving. It has to move because the flow is going that way. It's moving faster than the premix flame. It's the small animal which allows the flame to stay there. If you increase the speed too much, this thing goes away, the flame quenches. It's been proved by many experiments now. So we know that this animal is necessary so that afterwards, downstream, we'll have a diffusion flame. And you can create it in the lab, and you can also compute it, and we know a lot of things about this triple animal. When you do scatter plots, when you measure mixture fraction and fuel mass fraction in a zone like this one, you see that if you start from points which are here, you are on the mixing line. And when you go into these zones, you go into that, and you see that if you would keep going in this direction, you would end up with the ignited lines. And you see that the trajectory here is what I told you before. You go from mixing to ignited and fully burning states. And this is achieved thanks to these triple flames, which are really interesting animals. Okay, if you can, this is really an interesting thing to study. So you see, this is the thing which goes from the blue to the red lines. The interesting thing about that, you can compute by theory, but also numerically, its speed, and it's a strange speed. It goes like the flame speed of the premix flame here at the tip, because this is a premix flame here, scaled by square root of rho 1 over rho 2, which means this thing can be 2 or 3 times faster than SL0, and it's propagating to the left here. The last thing I want to mention is, in many cases, what we have is a flame which is not premixed and which is not a pure diffusion flame. The best example, and I've said that also yesterday, we want to separate reactant and oxygen before combustion, but then when we mix them, we try to mix them very fast so that they are premixed when they enter the chamber. But in practice, we never succeed. I mean, they are never perfectly premixed. In practice, in many engines, we suppose we would like to have an homogeneous value for equivalence ratio. Here, this is a PDF. It's an histogram, if you want, of the equivalence ratio. And in most cases, what we have is something like this. There's a broad distribution of equivalence ratio around the mean value, which means it should be premixed, but it's not really fully premixed. It's almost good. So one example of a famous experiment, which is called Prekinstar, was developed in Europe. We used that, I don't know, maybe 20 groups now. I've used it to compute LES of this system because they have measured almost everything. And this is a case where you have here a swirler, and you inject methane here. Again, you inject it here because you don't want to make a mixing chamber before because you think it's dangerous. So you inject it here. And this thing is very turbulent, very swirled. It's characterized by a very high level of swirl. So you expect everything to be mixed when you go to the flame which is here. But when you measure mixture fraction, so that means mixture fraction should be at only one value. And the value should be of the order of this one here. This is what we would like to have. In practice, when you look at the inflow here and you look at the Z distribution, you see it's not what you have. You have a broad distribution, and this is what we will call partially premixed flames. And most real flames today belong to this category, which really means also that this is what we've done for 10 years. We have computed Prekinstar as if it was premixed. That means we were using only one inlet value here, and we are removing the fuel, saying everything entering here is premixed. And we never got it right. Okay? We had to go to a simulation where we compute this thing. That's a pain because you have 16 holes here. You have to mesh all these holes and compute the mixing and all that. But you need to do that if you want to get the right result.
That's the question.
Sure.
You have some dots, I mean, above this adiabatic time.
Some? Please. Yeah, well, actually, this is a measurement, okay? So there's no bug in the code here. There's no code. This is a measurement. It's a typical indication of the error margins that you have on an experiment, because you see, this is a $1 million plot, okay? You need cars to measure temperature, and you need, it's all kinds of different diagnostics to measure mixture fraction. So, and these things are not exact. So this, you're right, you are above the limit which is here. It could be an error in the measurement. It could be also the fact that you have non-equal Lewis numbers. We're coming back to that, because if you have non-equal Lewis numbers, you can be a little bit above this theoretical line. But you're right, this is what we look at when you get these kind of things. You say, if I want to mimic that with a code, for example, if my code is Lewis equal unity, and if this is true, I will never go there, because I cannot go there with Lewis equal unity. But then you say, oh, it's not Lewis equal unity the problem, it's the measurement which is wrong, so it's not your fault anymore. So.
One more quick question.
Sure.
So the difference between triple flame and the partially premixed flame is just the swallow generator?
No, triple flames and partially premixed flame are just different animals. They don't live in the same world. You will find triple flames if you have diffusion flames. Okay. But partially premixed flames usually do not exhibit any triple flames because they are premixed. If you are premixed, you burn like a premixed flame.
But, the pure layer mix and the triple flame, so
yeah, well, they mix. But here, there are very limited time to mix because this is pure fuel, pure air. While in this case, for Preakin-Starr, you have a long tube here, and those things are supposed to mix before they arrive. This is the main difference. Okay, so now I have finished the easy part. Let me go now into the wonderful world of turbulent combustion. Now, this is a different business. So turbulent combustion is really everything we've said before, except that now the flow itself is going to be turbulent. So now we have two choices. Either you give up, or you accept that you're going to have to make assumptions, because obviously this problem that you see here, for example, this is an LES of a fully turbulent combustor. You're not going to be able to do that with the same precision that we did the laminar flames. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the phenomenology of turbulent flames, talk about modeling, premixed flames, diffusion flames, and what's happening in real systems. This is really, I think, for many of you, the heart of the problem, and I must say that unlike diffusion, like laminar flame theory, this is really a field which is moving every day. Okay, not everyone agrees on that. Many of the things I'm going to say are controversial issues. So let me start with the phenomenology. That's an easy one because everyone agrees on that. It's a long list of problems, basically. First thing is to say, why do we have to care about turbulent flames? Well, when the flow which feeds the flame becomes turbulent, where the flame itself also becomes turbulent. And since most flows correspond to high flow rates, they are all turbulent. And again, if you want to do something more than the candle and the lighter, you have a problem. So let's just do a small exercise to wonder which kind of flames you can do which are not turbulent. If you take a duct here, which is feeding your flame, and you compute the critical flow rate you can have in a system like this before you get turbulent, that means before the Reynolds number is more than 2,000, you will find out that this is not a large number. Okay, in the lab, if you have a tube of 1 centimeter, if you pass more than 0.2 grams per second in it, it will be turbulent. Okay, and in the lab, it's true that we have very small flow rates, but even 1 gram per second is small. I mean, in most labs, you have devices which will go to 1 kilogram per second, or let's say 500 grams. If you go to a big laboratory flame, then normally the maximum flow rate to be laminar will be 1, and then the typical flow rate will be 100. And of course, if you go in a gas turbine chamber, you should pass 1 gram per second to be laminar, but the flow rate is more like 10 kilograms per second. So there's no way, nothing in a gas turbine chamber is laminar. Everything's turbulent. And in a rocket engine, you should be at 10 grams and you are more like 1,000 kilograms. So there's no way you can be turbulent, and not even in the small passages anyway, there's no way you can be laminar, everything is going to be turbulent. Now the next thing I want to say is the following one. If you're doing a PhD with Ed Lowe, and you go to him and you say, the laminar flame speed of my mixture is 38, and he expects 39 or 40, he's going to give you a hard time. You're going to go back to your something wrong, you're a stupid PhD student, do something. It's just, you have to find 39, I want 39. So it's true that for laminar flame speed, we don't know them exactly, but still, the accuracy we expect is of the order of a few percent, maybe 5, you know. It depends. For stoichiometric flames, I mean, really, we're pretty good. For very lean flame, very rich flames, maybe we can argue. But still, the accuracy is very good compared to that. If I give you now a turbulent combustion system and I don't give you the answer, you won't be able to tell me if it ignites or not. That's 100% uncertainty. And that's the first thing you have to realize. As soon as you go into the turbulence world, everything gets uncertain. And it's so uncertain that in certain cases, you can even not predict if it's going to work or not. Of course, in the real world, when we build this combustor and we compute it, we have built and computed 20 other combustors. So we know what to expect. We know which constant we should take. You know, we are not too far. But if I bring you a fully new combustion system, no one's going to bet that he's going to get this thing right. Okay. Even to tell you if the flame is going to be stable or not in a system like this. And that's the state of the art today. And that takes me back to what I said yesterday. And I've seen students doing it. If this is too much for you, you should just leave the room, okay? Yeah, I've seen a lot of students hitting their heads on turbulent flames saying, there must be a way to do it well. No, it's very, very complicated. If you want to do something simple, stick to laminar flames. When you enter this door here, enter this room, it's going to be tough. Now, as I said yesterday, we are looking for big factors now. We are not looking for a 3% difference. We need, for example, for this case of engine, to improve by a factor of 20 the speed at which combustion takes place. 20 is a lot, okay? We're not talking about between 38 and 40 centimeters per second. We need to find factors of 20. Now, historically, that's always interesting to go back in history here. The people looking at that, they started looking at it for, like always, for the First World War. We're building tanks, and building engines for tanks. And they noticed that something was interesting in an engine is that if you would shake things before, combustion would be faster. So they did an experiment which is plotted here. It's in the book by Lafitte here, but the experiments go back to Mallard and Le Chatelier, French guys, beginning of 20th century. Very simple thing, which we still use today. You make a bomb, it's very similar to the Princeton bomb. You make a bomb, you put fans in it, you ignite a flame here, and you look at the time it takes to go to the maximum pressure. You see the pressure would go up to 10 bars, and you just measure the time. And you plot the time as a function of the mass fraction of CH4. And you do that first without moving the fan. So you did it in a laminar case, that's this plot here. Of course, you find that the time is minimum when you have the stoichiometric conditions, and you guys, you are combustion guys, you understand why. Because the flame speed is larger. Okay? You have a large flame speed, so it takes a small time to burn. And then you shake the fans, you move them, and then ignition takes place in the turbulent flow, and the time for combustion decreases to here. And this is where things get funny, because these guys at that time noticed that this time was almost one half of that one, so they say, when there is turbulence, the flame speed increases by 2. That was the model they had at the beginning of the century. They did not really understand how the interaction would take place. They would say, it's 2 because our measurement says 2. Of course, if you would take another bomb, another speed, you would not find 2. But that really shows you that this factor here, which increases flame speed, is important to predict because this is what we're going to have to do in real systems. Now, why is it 2 or more than 2? Those are cuts, experimental cuts. In a turbulent flame, okay? If it was a laminar flame, it would be flat. If it's a turbulent flame, you see all these convolutions. The first thing to say is that every convolution on the flame front increases the flame surface. Every increase of the flame surface increases the power, increases the flame speed. So when you say, I'm going fast, I have a large turbulent flame speed, it means you have a large wrinkling of the flame front. And who does the wrinkling? Okay, that's to first order turbulence does the wrinkling. to second order, somodiffusive instabilities also do wrinkling. I'm surprised that Paul has not shown you this. He has a great movie where you can see a flame which creates its own wrinkling. Actually, you've seen this morning some cellular shapes. Those things increase flame surface without turbulence. So in a turbulent flame, most of these things are created by turbulent eddies, but then in addition to that, you can even have funny thermodiffusive instabilities. But the first thing to remember is that you want more surface. You want more surface will mean faster combustion. The second problem, I mentioned that yesterday, when you see a small piece of flame here, is it if you could zoom on it, does it look like a laminar flame? Can we assume it's a laminar flame? If we can do that, we will call that a flamelet. It will help us a lot. It would help us a lot. So you have to imagine that what we're really facing is the following scenario. We have this laminar flame. Paul is talking about it. I've talked about it. We know almost everything about it. And now, instead of having a steady flow here, we are going to shake it with turbulence. Remember, I've shown you what turbulence was yesterday, you know, these noodles all together. So we're going to send this thing into the flame. This is a two-way interaction. The flame is going to be wrinkled by the flame front, but remember that the gases here are very viscous. It's not an obvious statement. Many people actually believe that burn gases are not viscous because they are confused by the fact that burn gases are light. So when you make a fire, you see them going up. But in practice, the viscosity goes up, the kinematic viscosity goes up like the temperature square. So these gases here, which are 7 times warmer than the fresh gases, are also 50 times more viscous. It's very viscous. So what will this viscosity do? It means that the vortices which are here, which will have the chance of going here, will be dissipated. There's a very classical example in the book of Lewis and von Elbe, when he shows a jet which is turbulent when it's cold, and when you ignite it, it becomes laminar. Okay. Combustion can actually make a turbulent flow laminar just because you increase viscosity. If the viscosity is 50 times larger, the Reynolds number will be 50 times less. So the first effect is that turbulence will wrinkle the flame. Okay? The flame will become like this. And more flame surface means more power. But the second effect is that the viscosity, which will increase like the temperature square, will decrease the turbulence. But there's another effect, is that the flame will also do another thing, which you have seen already, and you see why COE is so important. You know now that because of the flame here, there will be a strong acceleration in the burn gases. So if it accelerates, that means the Reynolds number goes up now. So you see, the Reynolds number goes down because of viscosity, but it goes up because of acceleration. The overall result is difficult to predict if you don't compute it. Okay, so when people started looking at that, they say, oh, well, this is too complicated to tackle like this. Let's try to classify those flames first. And this is the wonderful world of turbulent combustion regime and turbulent combustion diagrams. The people in this room working on turbulent combustion have probably seen that. Every guy in the field has tried to give his name to a famous diagram. So the way these diagrams are built, we try to guess what the result of the interaction between a given turbulence and a given flame will be. Depending on what? Depending on the speed of the vortex of the turbulence and depending on the sizes of the eddies. Now this is an old picture, an old movie, something I did when I was working a long time ago, where we basically sent turbulence, which is here, into a turbulent flame front. And you see how the turbulence reacts. You see also something else. Look at the vorticity here in the burn gases. It's completely going away because of dissipation. And so this is the wrinkling effect. This one is, when you look at it, almost all points here remain very small laminar flame. This is a case where flamelets assumptions are probably justified. But in a case like this, well, if you start looking at this kind of shape here, you see that to recognize a 1D flame, you could see, but here, for example, this doesn't really look like flamelets. So there are cases where you have flamelet regimes, there are cases where you don't have flamelet regimes, and what you do, you're trying to classify these things as a function of two things. The ratio of the integral scale to the flame thickness, the ratio of the integral velocity of turbulence divided by the flame speed. And if you just think in terms of dimensional analysis, you don't have many more parameters anyway. Okay, to first order, the only thing you know is that this turbulence has a given speed, a given size, and the flame has a speed and a size. So of course the diagram makes sense. To first order, this is the right way to do that. And you compare the turbulence input with the flame input. Now, this is one diagram. There are many variations in the literature. To tell you the truth, I've done like everyone else. I've plotted the diagram, and when it was finished, I've just thrown it away. Except to justify models, this is not really useful. So this is an example of diagrams. Here you can say, for example, if I have a very small intensity of turbulence, I have a laminar flame. Okay, surprise. If you have no turbulence, it's a laminar flame. That, I would know that. If you increase turbulence, well, you have flamelets, of course. I mean, if the turbulence is very slow, the flame is just going to be distorted a little bit. And so all these things are obvious, okay, that these regimes here. Where it's not obvious, it's what's happening if you have a very intense turbulence and you have scales which allow turbulence to go into the flame front. Then you start talking about corrugated flamelets, distributed reaction zone, whatever. Frankly, I just don't care too much anymore. That doesn't help you to solve the problem, okay? It's the description of what's going on. You can do the same thing for diffusion flames, and we've done it too. In practice, you use this diagram to justify your model. For example, if you build a flamelet, if you use a flamelet model, you try to show that you're here, okay? And if you want to kill your friend, you say, oh, you weren't here, you were here, so your model cannot be applied. It doesn't take you far. I think today we have played enough with these diagrams. You need to do better than that. The second notion in premixed turbulent flames, which is very important, is the turbulent flame speed. So a lot of people are talking about the turbulent flame speed as if it was something which exists. You know, I'm just going to show you the definition and show you that there is no turbulent flame speed. It's just a notion which is confusing. So how do you define the turbulent flame speed? You just take a turbulent flow, and here the flame will be turbulent, and you say the turbulent flame speed is the mean speed here, which allows the flame to stay there. So it's exactly like the laminar flame speed, but now we take into account the winkling of the flame. So you write a balance, and that again it's coming back to theory. You say here that the flow rate entering this square here, which is the A multiplied by ST, so ST is the flow velocity here. This flow rate must be equal to the flow rate going through the flame front, which is the turbulence, the laminar flame speed, multiplied by the surface here. And here I have assumed that I have a flamelet model. I have assumed that every small element here burns at the consumption speed. And this is again a statement related to conservation of mass flow rate. So this is a consumption speed. But when you go to turbulence world anyway, you don't have to worry about that. So ST here is going to be the flame speed, SL, multiplied by a parameter theta, which we call the winkling factor. Why do we call it the winkling? Because it's the ratio of the surface here divided by the cross-section. So if it's laminar, it's small. If it's turbulent, it gets to larger values. And people have tried to say that ST must be some kind of a generic value. So by the way, we have tried to plot ST as a function of U prime. That's the usual way we do it. And we see that when you increase turbulence, you increase ST. Okay, if you try to look, you know, for this formula on Google, you're going to find millions of hits. It's such a classical problem that I don't think it's worth working on it anymore. Because these curves have absolutely no generic value. If you take another flame, you're going to find another thing. If you take another fuel, you're going to find there is no turbulent flame speed. In other words, there is no formula for the turbulent flame speed which would be generic here. And we had fun a few years ago with my co-author Denis Venant here. We just compared measurements with different models for the turbulent flame speed. Each of these lines is a different model. The only common thing about them is that they don't go negative, okay? But because they're built this way. But they are all over the place, and we used only 8 models, but the dispersion is so large. So please don't write another paper saying, here is my formula for turbulent flame speed. It's not going to work, okay? So you cannot do it this way. Turbulent flames have to be computed, turbulent flames. You cannot say there's only one speed. That's not going to work. One of the reasons also why turbulent flame speeds don't have much meaning is that they are measured in bombs. And trying to correlate the speed of the turbulent flame with the turbulence inside the bomb is a very difficult exercise. It's one example here of a bomb. These bombs are all over the world. Okay, this is a computation of the bomb in Orléans in France, but as I said, Princeton has one. I'm sure Tsinghua has one. The Germans have many. So you put fans here, you turn the fans, and you ignite the flame just in the center. That's a very complicated experiment, because what you hope is that in the center, you should have isotropic, homogeneous turbulence in a small zone where the flame can nicely develop. Because the whole idea is that ST, the turbulent flame speed, should be a function of U prime, the turbulent speed, intensity, only if you are in a turbulent, isotropic, homogeneous case. Because if the turbulence has funny shapes, then of course the turbulence speed doesn't mean anything. And the turbulent flame speed is not meaningful. So everyone has been trying to build bombs where you have a small zone in the center which is isotropic and homogeneous. That's been the objective of many groups. And that's also very difficult to do. Because in this zone, you must have no variation, no mean flow, and you must have a certain level of turbulence. These bombs are all over the place. They started 40 years ago, or 50 years ago now, with those guys. It actually started with the bomb of Lafitte, you know, in 1907. And you can find them all over the place. Actually, even today, you know, everyone is still working on these bombs. The trick is, you look here, those are different equivalence ratio, and it's the same bomb. And you see the stoichiometric flames go faster than the others. And when you look at this kind of measurements, and actually, no, this is not the Princeton group, it's the English one. And you see that when you measure this radius and you redo the experiment many times, you get different results. Those are all kinds of results, and you see that the spreading of the results is really a problem. That means if you repeat the same experiment, you get a different flame. So right away, it tells you that the flame speed, for example, here is plotted. All these points should be together, but you see that the dispersion of the results is very large. Okay, I want to finish, before we take a break here, talking about other difficulties here. I've just talked about the data scatter. The results here depend a lot on the igniter system also. When you ignite with a laser or you ignite with a spark, usually the results will be different because the ignition phase is important. And of course, you cannot wait too long, because when the flame starts growing, then it will touch the wall, touch the fans. You cannot use the results. So you cannot start too early because the ignition phase is important. And you cannot wait too much because the flame will touch the wall, the pressure will go up. I mean, it's a complicated game. So the first thing is, do you have isotropic homogeneous turbulence? So you can do PIV in the center here of your system and try to see if it looks like homogeneous turbulence. It's been done by quite a few people. And usually people say it's not too bad. You know, they call it reasonably uniform isotropic turbulence. Whatever. This is the LES we did of this system. Actually, we have this moving mesh here, which allows to move all these fans at the same time. And you see that the problem is that the speed, of course, here is very small compared to the fans. The fans are turning at 20 meters per second. In the center here, this is where you hope to have isotropic homogeneous turbulence. In practice, this is a cut here. You have here the mean velocity, and here you have the IMS velocity. And you see the flame has to be very cautious, because here is what it should develop. As soon as the flame will go in this region, it will find different turbulence, even different mean flow. You cannot use it to guess any link between ST and U prime. It's just not going to be meaningful. So that's an example of a computation of ignition. You see the flame growing here in this isotropic field. But very rapidly, this flame starts, you know, to find the flow field, the mean flow field around it, and the results cannot be used. So that's a view of the flame kernel, and that's the view of the turbulence around it. And this is how we found correlations. Okay, we do experiments like this one, and then we try to plot ST as a function of U prime. But when you do the LES, you realize that this is a very noisy process. The errors are numerous, and you shouldn't rely on that to build a model. Like, except in many cases, you have to, but not a good idea. So just to finish here, range about flame speeds. You know, when we did talk about laminar flame speeds, I told you that you take a hydrocarbon flame in air, it's going to go like half a meter per second. You take a hydrogen flame, it can go up to 5, maybe 10 meters per second. If you take the maximum value, you can have probably is hydrogen oxygen at a high pressure up to 30 meters per second. After that, nothing laminar can go faster. But at the other end of the spectrum, you get the detonation. Those can go, you know, like 1.5 kilometers per second. And in the middle, here, the turbulent flame speeds can go, you know, all the way around. If when you add turbulence, you add a level of variations here that you can, you know, spread the whole domain here and have speeds which go from zero to also detonation. This is actually when you go from here to there. This is what we call DDT, so the deflagration to detonation process. And this is usually due to, not always, but usually due to turbulent flames. Okay, we're going to take another break and we start again in 10 minutes.